हेलो डियर स्टूडेंट्स, वेलकम टू लेक्चर 6 ऑन द चैप्टर रे ऑप्टिक्स एंड ऑप्टिकल इंस्ट्रूमेंट्स। स्टूडेंट्स, इन लेक्चर नंबर 5 वी डिस्कस्ड अबाउट टोटल इंटरनल रिफ्लेक्शन एंड देन वी डिस्कस्ड फ्यू इलस्ट्रेशंस ऑफ टोटल इंटरनल रिफ्लेक्शंस। इन दिस लेक्चर वी आर गोइंग टू डिस्कस ऑन रिफ्रैक्शन एट स्फेरिकल सरफेसेस, terms connected with spherical refracting surface, and finally we will be giving the relation between n, u, v and r for spherical refracting surface. Here n is refractive index, u is object distance, v is image distance, and r is radius of spherical surface. Now let us discuss these points one by one. Refraction at spherical surfaces. Spherical refracting surface. A small portion of a sphere of refracting material is called spherical refracting surface. Okay, if you have a sphere of refracting material and if that is cut into small portion, that portion, small portion, is called spherical refracting surface. There are two types of spherical refracting surfaces. One is concave spherical refracting surface. It is the spherical refracting surface in which the surface is concave towards rarer medium. Okay, this is the spherical refracting surface, and this surface, can you see this? This is towards or facing towards rarer medium. Such kind of spherical refracting surface are called concave spherical refracting surface. Second one, convex spherical refracting surface. It is the spherical refracting surface in which surface is convex towards the rarer medium. Okay, it is shown by diagram here, and this is a refracting surface, and this surface is concave towards rarer medium. Hence such kind of refracting surfaces are called as convex spherical refracting surface. Okay, now let us see the terms connected with spherical refracting surface. First one, aperture. The area of spherical refracting surface available for refraction is called aperture. Okay, we have a sphere and a part of sphere is taken, and this area is available for refraction. Hence, this part is called as aperture. Second term, pole. The midpoint of spherical refracting surface is called its pole. Okay, this point, the midpoint, this is the midpoint of this spherical refracting surface, and this midpoint is called pole. Third term, center of curvature. The center of sphere of which the given refracting surface forms a part is called center of curvature. See, this refracting surface is made from this sphere, and center of this sphere is called center of curvature. Fourth one, radius of curvature. The radius of the sphere of which the given spherical refracting surface forms a part is called radius of curvature. Okay, this is the sphere, and we have taken a part of the sphere, and radius of this sphere is called radius of curvature. Fifth point, principal axis. A straight line passing through pole and the center of the curvature of spherical refracting surface is called principal axis. The line which passes through pole and the center of the curvature of a refracting surface is called principal axis. Sixth term, paraxial rays. A ray of light making small angle with the principal axis of refracting surface is called paraxial rays of light, or the rays which are very close to principal axis are called paraxial rays. Next term, image. A point at which the rays of light from object after refraction through the spherical refracting surface actually meet or appears to meet is called image. 8th point, real image. Again, the images are of two types. One is real image and other one is virtual image. Let us see what is real image. A point at which the ray of light from object after refraction through spherical refracting surface actually meet is called real image. Okay, if the rays are converging at a point on the principal axis after refraction through the spherical refracting surface, then that image is called real image. That means we are getting that image. A real image can be obtained on the screen. Virtual image. A point at which the rays of light from object after refraction through the spherical refracting surface do not actually meet but appears to diverge from a point is called virtual image. Okay, in this case, we won't get image. Image will not be formed, but it appears that the rays are diverging from the point, and that point from where the rays diverge is called virtual image. A virtual image cannot be obtained on the screen. Object space. The space or medium containing real object or incident rays of light is called object space. Image space. The space or a medium containing real image or refracted rays of light is called image space. 12th term, object distance. The distance of the object from the pole of the spherical refracting surface is called object distance. Okay, it's an important one. We'll be using oftenly this word. What is object distance? The distance of the object from the pole of spherical refracting surface is called object distance. Image distance. Okay, it is represented by V. The distance of the image from the pole of spherical refracting surface is called image distance. Okay, these are the few important terms related with spherical refracting surface. Relation between N, U, V and R for a spherical refracting surface. Okay, here we are going to obtain relation between refractive index, object distance, image distance and radius of the spherical refracting surface. Consider a spherical refracting surface, and this surface is convex spherical refracting surface of refractive index N2, and this material is placed in a medium of refractive index N1. This line acts as a principal axis. Let O be the object placed in the medium of refractive index N1, and P is the pole of the refracting surface. A ray of light is incident at point N on the refracting surface and gets refracted along Ni. Another ray travels along principal axis, and these two rays intersect at point I, hence an image is formed at this point. Let I be the angle of incidence between incident ray and normal, and R is the angle of refraction between refracted ray and normal, and alpha is the angle between incident ray and principal axis, gamma is the angle between refracted ray and principal axis, beta is the angle between normal drawn at point N and principal axis, and let R be the distance between pole and the center of the curvature, and U is the object distance, that is distance between O and P, and V is the image distance, distance between P and I. Okay, this is the brief description about the given ray diagram. Okay, this is the description. I will skip this. Okay, now, since the aperture is very small, and this part will be flat one, it will be plane, and this part will be perpendicular to principal axis. Now, from triangle NOP, NOP, and this will act as a right angle triangle, tan alpha is equal to NP divided by PO. Tan alpha is equal to NP divided by PO, adjust opposite divided by adjacent. And from second triangle, NCP, even this is right angle triangle. Tan beta is equal to NP divided by PC. And from third triangle, NIP, tan gamma is equal to NP divided by PI. For paraxial rays, or if angle is very small, then tan alpha is equal to alpha, tan beta is approximately equal to beta, and tan gamma is equal to gamma. Then we can write this equation as alpha equal to NP divided by OP, beta is equal to NP divided by PC, and gamma is equal to NP divided by PI. Okay, from triangle NOC, I is exterior angle. See, from triangle NOC, angle I is exterior one. And this angle is sum of opposite interior angles. Okay, which are opposite interior angles? Alpha and beta are the opposite interior angles to this exterior angle. Therefore, angle of incidence I is equal to alpha plus beta. Now put the value of alpha and beta in this equation. We get I is equal to NP divided by PO plus NP divided by PC. Okay, let this equation be 1. Similarly, R equal to beta minus gamma. See, from triangle, NCI, beta is exterior angle. And R and gamma are interior angles, right? Therefore, directly I am writing the expression for R. R is equal to beta minus gamma. Now put the value of beta and gamma in this equation. We get R equal to NP divided by PC minus NP divided by PI. Okay, let this equation be 2. From Snell's law, N1 sin I is equal to N2 sin R. Now substitute the value of sin I and sin R. Before substituting the value of sin I and sin R, since the angles are very small, hence sin I is equal to I and sin R is equal to R. Why we are taking this approximation? Because these are paraxial rays. What do you mean by paraxial rays? The rays which makes very small angle with principal axis. Hence, we are approximating sin I is equal to I and sin R is equal to R. Then above equation becomes N1I is equal to N2R. Substitute the value of I and R in above equation. We get N1 into NP divided by PO plus NP divided by PC is equal to N2 into NP divided by PC minus NP divided by PI. Now take this N1 into the bracket, N2 in this bracket. We get N1 divided by PO plus N1 divided by PC is equal to N2 divided by PC minus N2 divided by PI. Okay, now by applying Cartesian sign convention to the distances, we have PO is equal to minus U, PC is equal to plus R, PI is equal to plus V. Okay, substitute these values in the above equation. We get N1 divided by minus U plus N2 divided by R is equal to n2 divided by r minus n2 divided by v. Therefore, when you rearrange all these terms, we get n2 divided by v minus n1 divided by u is equal to n2 minus n1 divided by r. See, if I take this term to left hand side and bring this term to right hand side, then we get n2 divided by v minus n1 divided by u is equal to n2 minus n1 divided by r. Okay, this is the relation between n, u, v and r. Okay, from this equation we can write it as, in generally we can write refractive index of image space divided by image distance minus refractive index of object space divided by object distance is equal to refractive index of image space minus refractive index of object space divided by radius of the curvature. Okay, we are going to apply this formula. You need to remember this formula for further discussion of the topics. The above expression holds good for all spherical surfaces. Thank you, students, and we'll be learning some more topics on this chapter in the next lecture.